It's good to see you or not see you again. This is another Wednesday night where we're live streaming our broadcast, and we're still under the coronavirus mandate. I miss you guys. I don't know what else to say except it just is really, really wearing on all of us, not being able to be together. But I do praise God for the technology that we have. I praise God that we can still come together. We can worship together. We can pray together. We can sing together. And I'm glad that you've joined us here. I hope that this evening's service is a blessing to you. We're going to take this time now and open in prayer and gather around and gather your families together. Make sure that you're using this time to be able to uplift the name of the Lord. But as we look at His Word tonight, I know He has something that He wants to say to us. I know that He's got something that's going to change our life. Anytime we open His Word, He has something like that. And then when we sing praise to Him, that's our offering to Him. So join me in prayer. Father God, I love You and I praise You and I thank You for this opportunity that You give us. I thank You, Lord, for Your mercy and Your grace. I just thank You, God, that You give us a chance to be able to worship You together. But Lord, we're not together. We've been separated here for a while and can't meet together because of the restrictions in place. And Lord, we just miss one another. I just pray, God, for the healing, Lord, the healing that happens, Lord, physical healing with all those that are sick and suffering from the coronavirus. And Lord, those that are going through difficult times right now, we just pray, God, for Your strength in a time of weakness. And then, Lord, we just pray for the church body. I pray that You would bring us back together soon. I pray, God, that You would just be able to put Your hand upon this and stamp this thing out so that we can gather and assemble and lift up Your name and make Your name great, Lord, in praise. I thank You for the opportunity that You are giving us, Lord, so I'm not taking this opportunity for granted. We just thank You that this broadcast can go out and, Lord, that we can worship together in this way. So I pray, God, that You would just put a spirit of worship upon everyone that's listening, wherever they are. I pray, God, that the message today, Lord, hits our heart and pricks our heart, Lord, and draws us closer to You. I pray, God, if there's someone listening that has never accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior, I pray for their salvation today. And I pray, Lord, for all those, Lord, who have accepted You, but, Lord, You know that we need to be closer to You. You know, God, that You desire us to be closer to You. And as we draw near to You today, God, we just pray that You would draw near to us. Draw us closer, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, I'm going to ask Barry to come up and lead us. So if you will, please stand and we'll praise the Lord together. Thank you.
He is our comfort, He is our peace, and He is our joy. And in that joy, we find His strength. As we sing, Holy is the Lord. As we sing together, we stand and lift up our hands. For the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. Together we sing. Holy is the Lord, God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory.
Amen. I tell you, as we gather here and we do a service and we broadcast it from a sanctuary that doesn't have anybody in it listening to it, and I know Brother Barry, we've talked about it. I know for me, I could stand and talk up here just like I'm talking to somebody else. It's different when you don't have somebody to be able to play off of and respond to, but I know how difficult it is just being able to sing to a bunch of pews, and it's a lot different than when we're all together and we're meeting here and we're all of our voices are lifting it up. So I want to tell him I appreciate that, and I know it's a challenge, but I hope you are singing at home. I hope that you are being able to lift up the Lord. And today, I have to tell you, I'm as excited today about bringing this message as I've ever been about bringing any message. You might say, well, it's a Wednesday night message. I hope you don't get too excited. Well, I've got my watch right here. I'm going to put it right here so that I can stay within the bounds of this, but it was something that happened to me this past week, and it inspired me on a message that I've been so excited to preach. So if you have your Bibles, I want you to stand up and raise your Bibles, raise them in the air, bear witness of God's Word, be able to give a testimony of the Word of God and the revelation that comes out of the Word of God. So you may be seated, please. And if you want to, you can go to Matthew 27, and then you can go to Luke chapter 22. Matthew 27 and Luke chapter 22. And you'll be able to see that there are a couple places that we're going to be at above that, but you can pretty much park at these two places. We'll be at Matthew 27 for just a couple of verses, but we'll start mainly in Luke 22. And then we're going to do a Bible study, since it is Wednesday night Bible study, but I guess it's going to be a message and Bible study together. You can choose which one you want to categorize it as we get through with it. But we're coming off of Easter, a week coming off of Easter where we celebrated. And this past Sunday, we learned that Jesus actually made the statement in John 3. He was talking to Nicodemus, and he said, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And we talked about Jesus being lifted up on the cross. We were able to see that he was comparing it back to Numbers chapter 21, where Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness for all those that were sick and that were dying. And we were able to relate this and understand that Jesus was saying, you need to look at me. And not just look at me, you need to look at me and believe in my power to heal you. And not so much of a physical sickness as it was in Moses' day, but as of our sin sickness. And so when he speaks this, he pretty much puts the point out there that people have to look to him and not so much look at his face as much as look what he was doing on the cross. And we see in Matthew 27, well, the physical example of this was being played out. So you're in Matthew 27. You can look at a number of verses. As Jesus was lifted up on the cross to be crucified, there were a lot of people that were looking at him. So I want you to put yourself in this spot and know that people were looking at him. You know how it is when somebody's looking at us. All eyes are on us. But Jesus had this a lot. And so as he was on the cross, he put himself in a place to where all eyes were on him. And we see, even in verse 36, it tells us that the Roman soldiers as they were crucifying him, they looked at him. Verse 36 says, and sitting down, they watched him there. You see, that's specific. They sat and just watched him dying, watched every belabored breath. They watched everything that was going on with him. And then we get to verse 39 and we learn that people came by and they looked up at him and they insulted him. So it wasn't just that they were looking at him. How would you feel if you were somewhere? It was bad enough that somebody was looking at you, but they were looking at you, insulting you. And then we get down to verse 41 and we see that even the chief priests and the scribes and the elders came by and looked up at him and mocked him. So he was the center of attention. He was being looked at. And we talked about he had to be lifted up in what he did in order for people to look at it and be saved. So I want you to understand they were all looking up at Jesus at the cross, but they were looking with disbelief. And they were saying, if you're the one that you say you are, then prove it. Save yourself right now. Come down. And Jesus, understand, was always being criticized. But Jesus was also looked at by a large number of people that did believe. And as he went around doing his ministry, he would do the unbelievable. He would do these miracles and he would say these things. And you can't imagine the crowds that he would draw. Just being able to hear him speak, and you hear the scripture make reference to the fact that he spoke with such wisdom. Even when he was 12 years old, he was anointed by God. He spoke and he taught the teachers with such wisdom. So a crowd would come around him. They were looking at him. And he was always able to draw a crowd. They heard what he said, and some believed, and some people still didn't believe. Now for several weeks, I think back about what we've been talking about. We've looked at Jesus. We've looked at Jesus. How do we look at Jesus? We open the Word, right? This is the revealed Word of God. And as many people say, even the name of the last book in the Bible, the Revelation. They call it Revelations. It's supposed to be Revelation. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. He's revealed to us. But he was revealed to us in the Gospels. He's revealed to us through the Old Testament, talk about his coming. But that's the way we look at him. And what have we been looking at? Think about it. What have we been looking at? You see, leading up to the time of Easter, we've been looking at the events leading up to Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry, the crucifixion, all the way back to when he came into the Garden of Gethsemane. He told his disciples to go and prepare the room. We've looked at everything that he said. We've looked at Jesus as he stood before the religious council in Jerusalem. We've looked at Jesus as he stood before Governor Pilate. We looked at Jesus as he hung on the cross. We looked at Jesus as he was buried. We looked at Jesus as he was risen from the grave. And all these things that happen, we look and we watch his actions. And we hear what he says. And then we make a decision as to whether we want to believe that or we don't want to believe that. Some people even today, well, they'll look at it during the Easter week. And then they won't look at it again until next Easter week. And then some of us, we look at it, and then life gives us plenty of other things to look at, and so we look back at something else. But understand, we have to look at these things, and we talk a lot about what Jesus did. And today is going to be a little different, because in all this time that we see that Jesus made himself available for us to look at and for others to look at, I began to think about something that really moved me, and I haven't really focused on this before in my mind the way that I have lately. But I had the thought, when everybody was looking at Jesus, what was he looking at? You think about it. What was he looking at? And even now, when we're looking at Jesus and what he did, what is he looking at now in us? I mean, we open his Word and we see all these things about Jesus and we look at him, but what is he looking at? When I began to think about what it looked like through his eyes, it changed me. I have to tell you, it changed me. I think it was the point where I was reading that the soldiers were looking at him. The people that were walking by were looking at him and insulting him. The chief priests were walking by and mocking him. And I thought, well, Jesus has the highest seat in the crowd. He's up on the cross. As he's looking at the soldiers, as he's looking at the people, as he's looking at the chief priests, what is he thinking? What is he looking at? He has a thief beside of him to look at. And so it began to hit me because I don't think I had thought this deeply into it. And so just like you go back in Luke 19, and you can make reference to this in your notes, and I'm going to give you plenty of scripture you can go back and look at. Some you'll have time to read with me here, and some you'll just mark. But if you were to go back in Luke 19 and look, we're given the account of the triumphal entry, Palm Sunday. And think about this. Verse 41, it says, when he was come near, talking about almost at Jerusalem, when he was come near, he beheld the city. So when he saw the city, what was going on in the city? Well, what was going on in the city is they were breaking off the palm branches and they were laying their garments in the street. We learned about that, right? But it says, when he beheld the city. So now we want to look at what Jesus looked at. So what's the difference? They were celebrating. You know what this verse said he was doing? He was weeping. So Jesus was seeing something different than the other people were seeing. You know, I have to tell you, I was watching a movie about the life of Christ, and I'd been studying and studying about looking up to Jesus. And if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. And my focus was so much on looking at Jesus and looking at Jesus. And in this movie, there was a part in this movie, and it's one of those movies that, you know, were put out about the life of Christ, and you say, well, you know, those movies aren't accurate. And I hear people all the time, those movies aren't accurate, and that doesn't really display. And listen, believe you, Angie will tell you, I can sit on a lot of those movies, and, you know, I'm not the guy you want to watch the movie with sometimes if I want to be verbal about it. Well, it didn't happen this way, didn't happen this way. And so, yeah, I've tried to get over that because there's something bigger that's happening. I mean, I can read my Bible and I can discern when something happened, but I'm watching something that's a visual to me. And visual is always good. Visual lets us be able to see something in a way that we wouldn't normally see it. And I was watching this movie, and I just want to share my heart with you. And in this movie, the character that played Jesus, or the person that played Jesus, it's like he had these piercing eyes. And there was a point in the movie where Jesus was leaving. He was walking out this certain way. I was sitting there on the couch with family and I was watching this, and it seemed like just a regular part of the movie that nobody would have paid attention to, but he was walking away and someone stepped and they were watching him walk away, and he stopped and he turned completely around and looked at that person that was watching him. That person would eventually be a disciple that followed him. He turned and looked at that person, and I guess the person, they were a picture of the camera that was taking the shot of Jesus looking. But all I could see was Jesus looking straight at me when he was looking at that person. And the look that he gave, I tried to wrap my mind around it. All this happened in a split second. All I can tell you is when he turned around and looked at that person, all I could see on the screen was Jesus looking at me. And you can say what you want to. You can call me weak if you want to, whatever, but it's as if I lost my breath at that time. I took a breath and all of a sudden I welled up with tears and, you know, I had to get up and leave. Because something physically happened to me when Jesus looked at me in that meeting. And you say, oh, well, you're just going to the extreme here. Well, I knew immediately that there was something to it because he moved me. He moved me. The Spirit moved me. It wasn't so much the movie. It's just that I saw Jesus looking at me. And from that time, my mind went off of me looking at Jesus because I had checked that mark. And I knew I was in my Word looking at him and checking that mark. But for the first time in a long time, in a different way, all I could see was Jesus looking at me. You see, he didn't say a word when he turned and looked at that guy, but it was the look. You know how we look at each other sometimes. And you know, I know it was a movie, but I was overwhelmed. And I thought about how it's going to be when when I stand in His presence one day. And I know this was just an actor portraying Jesus, but how's it going to be when I stand in front of Jesus and He looks at me? How's it going to be when you stand in front of Jesus and He looks at you? And we can sort of even put that thought off. Well, I have an idea, but I want to give you an even more surreal thought. What will His look say to you without words? Like, what will you be able to read in His look? And even this, what about right now? What kind of look is Jesus giving you right now? What kind of look would He be giving me right now? Because you say, well, hey, you saw that movie and your mind's all wrapped around it. You see, Jesus is always looking. He's the good shepherd. If I'm His, He's looking. And so I've stopped thinking about everybody else. Of course, I'm concerned of how He looks at you, but man, it's changed me. You know, I got up from there, and you'll, as crazy as this is, and you say, well, you're a preacher, and you're always in His Word, and you're praying and stuff, and I appreciate that, but when I got up and excused myself, I had this thought and thinking to myself, can you imagine being in the presence of Jesus Christ? And I went back to my room and I just surrendered to God all over again. And I said, I want to be that disciple. You're looking at me. It tore me up. And you say, well, you should have been at that spot. Well, I thought I was. I don't want to reveal my vulnerability to you, but you have it also. I can see why somebody would have been around Him, and as He looked at them, how they would have just followed Him and wanted to hear everything. I was ready to be able to say, Jesus, I want to be the servant that You want me to be. I will do whatever You want me to do. I will go wherever You want me to go. Because I was envisioning that look. You see, we've all made the statement before. You've said it, I've said it. I saw how You looked at me. Have you ever made that statement? Somebody said something, and I know sometimes it's a thing at our house, and Angie will say something, and I won't say anything back, and then all of a sudden she'll go on as if I have said something back, and I'll say, well, I didn't even say anything. She said, well, I saw how you looked at me. I know what you mean. And I'll try to defend that by saying it's hard enough for me to defend what I say, much less what you think I say. But it all came in a look. She said, you have different looks. I know how you look at me. Well, how do you think Jesus looks at us? I began to search the Scriptures about what Jesus sees when He looks at us. And I want to share it with you today, if you'll let me. I want you to see through His Word. It's a lot of different places, so I won't stay in the places for long. And really, it's like telling you a whole lot of stories. And I love the stories of the Bible. But I want you to see this common denominator in all these stories that I share with you today. And I hope that you leave this message seeing the same thing that I saw last week. I hope that you see Him looking straight at you. And I hope that it's not a scary thought when He looks straight at you. I hope you're overwhelmed with emotion, because I was not unhappy when He looked at me. I was overwhelmed when He looked at me. You think about Luke's account in Luke chapter 22. And I think about the different looks that led up to this. You think about Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane as He was looking at His disciples sleeping when He told them to stay awake, right? And then you think not long after that, Judas. What kind of look do you think He gave Judas as Judas walked up to Him to kiss Him? What would you read in that look? But let me bring it back personal, because we're given an intentional description in Luke chapter 22 as it goes on. It talks about as Peter betrayed Jesus as He was taken into the home of the chief priest. And He was being mocked and accused and ridiculed. And Peter was standing out in the courtyard at a distance. And he had denied Jesus three times. You know the story, right? Listen to verse 61 of Luke 22. I want you to listen to these words. It says, "And the Lord turned and looked upon Peter." Now this is heavy. I'm not trying to dramatize this. I'm trying to say the Lord turned and looked at Peter. Now does it say he said anything? No. It was just a look. It says, "And the Lord turned and looked at Peter, and Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said unto him, before the cock crows, thou shalt deny me thrice." Now look at verse 62. Look at what that look moved Peter to do. It says, "And Peter went out and wept." How? Bitterly. I'm talking about ugly crying. I'm talking he couldn't catch his breath. Why? Because Jesus Christ, his master, looked at him. He didn't say a word, but he looked at him, and Peter knew exactly what that look meant. You say, well, how could Peter know? Well, Peter actually even knew in remembrance back to what Jesus had told him. It jarred his memory. It was a look of conviction. I want you to think about this vivid picture that God wanted us to see, that he intentionally put in Luke's account of what happened. The Lord turned and looked upon Peter. When Peter denied Jesus the third time, there were no words spoken to Peter. There was just the look that Jesus gave to Peter. And we have to know there was more in that look than can ever be put into words in this scripture. What kind of look must it have been? Was it a look of hurt and betrayal? You know, I saw that look before in another movie. And maybe you've seen this movie, maybe you hadn't, but a more common movie that you might have seen, since you don't know which account I saw of the story that I'm telling you about of the life of Christ. Maybe you've ever seen the movie Braveheart. And in Braveheart, there was a scene where there was someone that was fighting against William Wallace, and they were on a horse, and they were going to joust each other, and it was the enemy that had come, and he knocked him off the horse, and he was about to stab him, and he pulled his mask off. And it was supposed to be the person that was supporting him, Robert the Bruce. Does anybody remember that? If you ever think about that look that was on Mel Gibson's face when he looked up, it was a look of betrayal. It was a look of hurt. I can't believe you did this to me. Think about what's in a look. And think about what must have been in that look that Jesus looked at Peter with. You see, Peter and Jesus' relationship started with a look. If you were to go back to John chapter 1, verse 42, it says, "And Andrew brought Simon Peter to meet Jesus." And you know what the Bible says? It says, "And Jesus looked at him and said, thou art Simon, son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Cephas," which is by interpretation a stone, or Peter. You know, their relationship started with a look. I wonder what was in that look. Was it a look of acceptance? "Hey, Peter, this is Jesus." Can you imagine Andrew? "Peter, his brother, this is Jesus." Jesus looked at him and introduced and said, "I know who you are already." But then think about this. It doesn't stop there. The Bible's full of stories. And so if you were to flip back and go a couple of pages back to Luke chapter 19, if you're in Luke chapter 22, you'll see that there's a story about a man named Zacchaeus. And I want to read to you this story. Not the whole story, of course, but I just want to read to you a couple of verses here, if I may. Just two verses. Verse 5 and 6. I want you to think about the look that Zacchaeus received from Jesus. It says, "When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at your house. Zacchaeus, he made haste and came down and received him joyfully." And I thought to myself, well, I've never looked at it this way. I've looked at Zacchaeus in the tree. I've looked at what he used to be. I've looked at him being in Jesus' house. But can you imagine the moment, the look up in the tree? Think about it. It had to be a look of love and invitation. It wasn't that Zacchaeus was inviting him. Jesus was inviting Zacchaeus, come down. Throughout the New Testament, we hear Jesus give that invitation, come to me, right? So it was a look of love, an invitation. And then there was times when Jesus looked at other people as far as crowds. And there were different kind of looks. We read in Matthew chapter 9 that there were people that were gathered and Jesus looked upon them. And verse 36, it says, when he saw the multitudes, do you know how he describes it? He was moved with compassion because he looked at them as sheep without a shepherd. And he turned his disciples and he said, hey, look at all them. I'm moved with compassion. I want them to be a part of God's family. He said, the harvest is plenty, but the laborers are few. Go back and read Matthew 9 sometimes and you'll see the look that Jesus must have had when he looked at those people. It wasn't, hey, look at what they're doing and look at the way they're scattered and look at what they're focused on now and it's not me. No, he was moved with compassion. And then if you were to look a couple of chapters over in Matthew chapter 14, there's an episode there that happened that a lot of people know. It's when Jesus fed the 5,000. And Jesus, well, he had these crowds of people following him and following him. When you get to verse 14, it says he looked on the people. He looked on the people. He looked on them. And he was moved with compassion. So what's a look of compassion look like? What's a look of empathy? It's a look of mercy. It's a look of care. You know if someone's given you that look before, right? And Jesus, well, he's willing to give that look to anybody, isn't he? But you know, there are many looks that Jesus can give. And so if you were to go to Mark chapter 3, you say, well, we've got a lot of places to go to. You don't have to go to them all. This is a Bible study for crying out loud. We're going through the Bible. The Bible is what we're looking at. In Mark chapter 3, we see a scene where Jesus was being followed by the Pharisees to see if he was going to heal this man that had a withered hand on the Sabbath, because they wanted to criticize him and trap him in an act of legalism that he was violating. And so this man had a withered hand and Jesus was going to heal him, and they were just sitting there with bated breath saying, if he does this on the Sabbath, we're going to ring him up. They're talking to the Son of God. And Jesus looked at them and thought, you are so trapped in your legalism that you don't recognize the Son of God is standing in front of you. The Bible says in verse 5 of Mark 3, when he had looked round about on them, listen to this, with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their heart, he said unto the man that had the hand, stretch forth thy hand. He stretched it out, and his hand was restored whole as the other. You see, before Jesus did this miracle, he looked round about him and saw the attitude that everybody was watching him with. You see, they were looking at him, but he was looking at them. And then I think it's neat in this story, you have to consider, then he turned and looked at the man that had the withered hand. It was a different kind of look, wasn't it? Stretch out your hand. You see, everybody gets a different look according to how you look at him. Think about it. We get a different look according to how we look at him. In Matthew chapter 6, consider this. In one of the greatest sermons that we have on record here in Matthew 6, as he's standing and he's preaching and he's telling people, trust God, the God of provision. Don't worry. Don't be anxious. Store not up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and rust doth corrupt and thieves break through and steal, but store up for yourself treasures in heaven where moth and rust doth not corrupt and thieves do not break through and steal. Listen, he's talking about your heavenly Father being able to supply everything that you need. He's talking about for a child of God, a believer, there's no need to worry. And then he gets down to verse 30. And he's looking here, and he's seeing, he's preaching a message, but he's looking into the people's heart. Because he makes a statement in verse 30. You know what he says? after he speaks about God clothes the grass of the field. That's here one day and gone the next. He does that with such beautiful flowers. Then he makes this statement. Look at the end of verse 30. O ye of little faith. Jesus was preaching what they should do, but seeing what they were doing. He was looking, or he wouldn't have used the phrase, O ye of little faith. Can you imagine that look from Jesus as he was saying, God will supply everything you need if you will just believe and seek him first, and that there is no need to worry? But saw the worry? It must have been a disappointment that was in his look, that they were consumed with their own worry. He's talking about the Heavenly Father, but he's seeing worry. O ye of little faith, must have been said with a look of disappointment. In Mark chapter 12, we read a story that happened in verses 41 through 44. We read about Jesus sitting in the temple courts. And in the temple court, understand, there were different receptacles hung in the temple courts. We could go into that, but I'll just say different receptacles in the temple courts, and they were there to receive the offerings that people would bring in. And people would bring in and put their offerings in there. And some people wanted to come in and make a big show. They loved for people to see how much they were putting in. It would be like us putting $100 in this thing, but doing it all in quarters. You know, ding, 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 or counting out dollar bills and doing it so that as many people could see. So he was watching all this happen. But understand, Jesus was sitting watching, looking. This is important. He was looking how people were giving to God. The Bible tells us, as he was looking at the people as they brought their offering, we read verses 41 through 44. It says this, And Jesus sat over against the treasury and beheld how the people cast money into the treasury, and many that were rich cast much in. So when you see the word beheld, he wasn't just taking a glance. Beheld means, what was he doing? He was looking, he was studying it, right? Now listen, verse 42. And there came a certain poor widow, and she threw in two mites, which made a farthing. And he called him his disciples and said unto them, Verily I say unto you, that this poor widow hath cast more in than all they which have cast into the treasury. For all they did cast in of their abundance, but she of her want did cast in all she had, even all her living. You say, why is this significant? You see, Jesus not only looked, he told the disciples what to look for. Now this is pretty significant, because as I thought about this story, what I began to do is imagine the look that he gave those who were giving for their own glory and recognition. Can you imagine that look? You saw someone that was doing it, and he knows that he's here to die for them, to bring glory to Father God. And they're in there making people think they're bringing glory to God, but they're actually bringing glory to themselves. Can you imagine the look? Because he knows the heart. And then, imagine the look he gave to the widow who unselfishly gave. Why? Because she wanted to. You see, there must have been a look of disgust for those that gave for their own glory and recognition. But for the widow, there must have been a look of admiration. Think about that. All in one setting, a look of disgust and a look of admiration. You see, all those other people wanted to do is be admired by everyone. But the only one that mattered how they looked at you was Jesus. And he admired the widow. And then flip a couple of pages back and go to Mark chapter 5. We hear about a woman who was healed of her issue of blood. And these stories that may sound familiar to you, I want you to look at just the key things. This is why I'm giving them to you. She came up behind Jesus in the crowd, and she touched the hem of his robe. And verse 32 said, and I love this, and he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. Now, do you get the visual picture? She touched his robe, and what did he do? It's almost as if he spun around to do what? To look at her. He looked round about, but the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. Now, I'm thinking about this, and this is big. Can you imagine the look from Jesus that came to that woman? Through the crowd, she touched his garment. How would anybody know? But Jesus knew who was looking to him. And he turned around and looked straight at her. Can you imagine what that look beheld? As his piercing eyes met hers? Well, I know. I felt like I was feeling it. She was overwhelmed. So much so, it says she fell at his feet and she told him all. That means she said, "I did it, Jesus." Was he mad? No. You see, the look that he gave her was a look that showed such approval. You see, we know this because Jesus was pleased with her. He looked at her and he said, "Woman, your faith has made you whole." That look of approval. Have you ever gotten the look of approval? Isn't that a great look? We all love that look. Have we ever considered if that's the look that we're getting from our Lord and Savior? Well, I have been. It doesn't really matter what somebody else tells me as far as if they think I am. It matters the way I see Jesus looking at me. And when I began to visualize Jesus looking at me and realize there's a lot of looks that I could be getting, and I see a multitude of different looks in all these stories, well, it really hits my heart. I think about how you could be standing on either side of a situation. You know, we're fickle kind of creatures. We could be in trouble and think that everybody's looking at us the wrong way. And it's during those times that we turn to the Lord. And He'll give us a look that nobody else gives us, and it's the greatest look in the world. I know that because when I was all by myself and alone, I looked to Him and He looked back at me and opened His arms, and I didn't deserve it. But I've also been in that position to where you looked at other people and you made your own judgment of people, as if you were the one that could determine how you should look at somebody. And I think about the story in John chapter 8. And you can read this story in verses 1 through 11 of John chapter 8. But it was the story of the woman caught in the act of adultery. And if you think about standing on one side or another of a situation, you have to consider what was going on here. You see, this woman was caught in the act of adultery, which was wrong. And here is Jesus, the ultimate judge. And they're wanting to test Jesus. And they bring this woman out in front of Jesus to see what He's going to say, because He's claiming to be the Son of God. And here are all these people. And they bring this woman who was truly guilty. And they cast her right there in front of Jesus. And they pick up stones in their hand. And they're ready to stone this lady, because the law said that she should be stoned. And as they pick them up to make judgment and carry this out, Jesus looked at the woman. Then He looked at the crowd. Then He stooped down and He wrote on the ground. Then He stood up and He looked at the crowd again. All in the look, think about it. And He said, "He who is without sin, cast the first stone." The Bible says that they all begin to go away. You see, it only matters how Jesus looks at you. They were putting themselves in the seat of one who judges. And there is only one judge, and that is God. And He judges through His Son, Jesus Christ. The look that Jesus must have had to them was a look of inspection and judgment. He looked right through them. He was able to say, anybody here that is sinless, go ahead and throw your rock. And he's looking. Imagine the look of Jesus as he pans the crowd. And people begin to see his look, and then they see their own sin. That wasn't the last look. Then we see Jesus looks back at this woman. And he picks her up and says, where are your accusers? There is none. He said, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. What kind of look was that? When everybody in the world was looking at her a certain way, Jesus looked at her with love, with mercy, and with forgiveness. The same Jesus that looked with inspection and judgment the other way looked back at her with love, mercy, and forgiveness. Guys, that's big. And you can be on either side of that situation. And it all comes down to how I'm seeing Jesus look at me. You see, the only one that we really need to be concerned with how they look at us is Jesus. Because Jesus is continually looking over our actions here. One day, do you realize that it's not a movie? We're going to stand in front of Jesus face to face. I'm almost overwhelmed thinking about it. If a movie did that to me and I saw him look at me in this way, you say, well, you're giving a lot of credit to the movie. I'm saying the Holy Spirit moves you in a certain way when you visualize something the right way. But it's not a movie. It's not a dream. The Bible tells us we'll all stand face to face with Jesus Christ. And for people that say, I'm going to say this and I'm going to say that, you won't be able to say a thing. You're going to be standing in the presence of the Son of God. And there won't be anything you can say because of the way He's looking at you. There won't be an answer. He is the one and true, only righteous judge. Jesus Himself in Luke 21, when He was talking about that day coming, He said, watch ye therefore and pray always that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass. He was talking about the tribulation times and to stand before the Son of Man. You see, Jesus was alluding, even in Luke 21, about the day of the Lord when He came back and when He was going to judge, to be able to escape those evil things and stand in front of Jesus Christ. And Paul reiterated in Romans 14, listen to verses 10 through 12. He said, but why dost thou judge thy brother? Why dost thou set at naught or look down at thy brother? Listen, for we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, when He says it is written, that means that God has put it here. He's quoting Scripture. As I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then, every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. You might be able to block out that look right now, but every one of us are going to stand in the visual presence of Jesus Christ. And I began to think, and I can't get it out of my mind, the picture of Jesus looking right into my eyes. And I think, what kind of look is He giving me? And what kind of look is He going to give me? Will it be a look of hurt or betrayal? Will it be a look of welcome and acceptance? Will it be a look of invitation? Will it be a look of compassion and empathy and mercy and care? Will it be a look of anger because of disbelief? Because He's going to give some of those looks. Will it be a look of disappointment that I'm consumed by my worry? Oh, that's a big one. Will it be a look of disgust because of my pride or my selfishness? Or will it be a look of admiration because of my unselfishness? Or will it be a look of approval that He gives me because, you know, that's the greatest look you can get? You know, we need to realize Jesus gives everybody a look of love, a look of invitation, a look of acceptance. And maybe you can remember, if you're saved, when you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, it was at that time that you actually were able to see yourself because you saw Jesus looking at you. That's the way you hold yourself accountable. That's what enters your mind, because otherwise you won't look at yourself that way. We'll justify what we're doing and we'll say we're not that bad. We'll say, well, we're not selfish. And here's the reason. Or we're not really worried, but then we go back. You see, we've got to look at the way Jesus looks at us and say, how does He look at us? And my mind was spurred when I saw just that visual picture, and I thought, I need to keep this every day. Because there's so many looks that Jesus gave in Scripture. I could be on either side of a situation, even being a believer. I want Him to look to me with approval, admiration. I want Him to look to me with love and mercy. What we need to know and see right now is that Jesus is looking at us. We don't need to be scared about it. I'm not giving you a message that you can be scared about, that Jesus is looking at you and He sees you doing this. Don't be scared about it. What we need to see Him doing is looking at us and purpose in our life how we want Him to see us. That's what we need to get in our mind. How do I want Him to see me? How do I want Him to look at me? You see, our love for Him, our belief for Him, our acceptance of Him, our actions in this life that express all these things determine how Jesus looks at us. All these things determine it. It's so easy for us to drift off on the selfish side, on the prideful side, on the side that judges, on the side that refuses and is in disbelief, on the side that worries, isn't it? But man, when I see Him look at me, I've got to be like that lady. I had the issue of blood. I mean, when her eyes met His and she saw that, she fell at His feet. And that's what I'm doing. I'm seeing Him look at me and I'm saying, guilty, but I don't want to be. Guilty, but I don't want to be. And so, I invite you today to consider how Jesus is looking at you. What look will He give you when you see Him face to face? And we will. We must all stand at the judgment seat of Christ. And then others who've refused Him, they'll stand at the white throne judgment. You're going to see Jesus. Every person's going to see Jesus. What look will He give you? Will it be acceptance? Come on in. Or will there be other looks? And then if that's too far away for you to think about or even consider, and probably even better, think about what look that you're getting now. How's Jesus looking at me now? And that's what we need to carry around with us every day. So in a time where we think about Jesus being on display and making Himself available to look at in the Garden of Gethsemane, at the house of the chief priest, hanging on the cross, in the tomb, resurrected, all the time we're looking at, how is He seeing us when He looks at us? How is He seeing our belief? How is He seeing our actions? How is He looking at us? And so, look through His eyes today. See yourself. Ask God to let you see Jesus looking at you every day. And if you've never accepted Jesus as your Savior, well, that feeling that you're feeling right now, that feeling of nervousness, that's just Jesus looking at you. But it's a look of invitation. It's a look that says, I don't care what you've done. I died for you. I paid a price for you. There's nothing that you did was so awful that I can't forgive. I'm looking at you with mercy. But if you refuse, then you get a different kind of look. So we choose how he looks at us. Isn't that crazy? It's up to us. It's our free will that he gives us. And so, as for me, I want to see that look. That's a look of approval. I want to see that look that's a look of love and companionship. How about you? Maybe you've accepted him and you know that it's easy for you to get on the other side of a situation. Maybe you're not positive right now that you're getting the look that you would love to have. You say, what do I do? Well, the first thing you've done is recognize it. See him looking at you. Look through his eyes right now at you. Look through his eyes at you. And if you don't see anything, then glory to God. If you don't see anything but love and admiration for you, glory to God. If you don't see anything but approval for you, glory to God. Then please start praying right now for those of us that need to change some things. But if you're looking through his eyes and you see that there's some things you need to change, then glory to God. What do? You admit them. You confess them. You ask for forgiveness. And you keep looking through his eyes at yourself on an everyday basis. He'll forgive you. The Bible says if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you your sins and cleanse you from unrighteousness. Father God, I love you. I praise you for your word. I praise you for the truth of your word. Thank you, Lord, for letting us see you look at us today. God, let us always see that look. Let us always see you looking at us, Lord. Let it motivate us. Let it convict us. Let it comfort us. And I pray if there's someone listening, someone watching that's never accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior, Lord, look at them right now. Let them see you. Compel them to come to you and cry out to you and ask for forgiveness of their sins and ask you to be their Savior. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I shall see him by and by. Only faintly now I see him with the darkened veil between. But a blessed day is coming when his glory shall be seen. Face to face I shall behold him, far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all his glory I shall see him by.
Amen. Amen. I appreciate you being with us today, and I appreciate the Lord letting us be able to look through his eyes today, and I pray this happened for you. So until we meet the next time, until the Lord lets us be able to gather together again, we'll keep looking through his eyes at ourselves. And church family, I miss you tremendously. I can't wait to get back together with you. What a wonderful time it's going to be when we're able to get back together. But during this time, know that you're not alone. And know that it's going to be that much more sweeter. So be praying for those that are going through these difficult times. And I tell you, if you're going through a time and you're in need please let me know. I want to make sure that there's nobody that's in need that we can't help in some sort of way. But we're praying for you. Pray for each other. Contact each other. Make sure that the body is working together during this time. I love you, and I want to close you in prayer. Father God, thank you for this time you've given us. We praise you for who you are, and we thank you, God, that you've put us into a body that can worship and function, Lord, to be able to glorify your name. I pray, God, as the message goes out today and continues to go out, that you would use it to change lives. Lord, we thank you for another time that you revealed yourself to us. We praise you. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.